semantic analysis we are introduced two terms, syntax directed definition and syntax directed translation. Please see this book of Aho's book, and in some other books, Godzen book, there is context sensitive analysis. There is another good name for this, so you should see another book also if you are interested. Otherwise, Aho's book is complete, self-complete. So this context sensitive analysis, please don't confuse this context sensitive grammar. We are always discussing here unambiguous deterministic context free grammar with unambiguous grammar, and mostly we are at the LR1 parsing or CLLR1 parsing. Look ahead only once. So semantic and syntax directed definition, syntax translation. What is the role of semantic after so much fanfare of the syntax analyzer checking and all these things? What extra things semantic analysis? Then intermediate code, why are you going for intermediate code? Because you know, if there are m number of languages, n number of target machine, you have to write independently m into n compilers. But if we go for front end, m front end and n back end, then the complexity is m plus n. So that is the reason we go for intermediate code generation. And so what extra thing and the syntax analysis? Because see, variable declaration, say whether the variable is integer, floating point, whenever you declare in C and Java, not Python, C and Java, that particular declaration doesn't follow any our context free grammar. Okay, so that is the thing. The type checking should be done at the semantic analysis. Semantic analysis, most two things are done. One is coercion. Coercion means you are forcing integer to floating point number. Like whenever you are calculating mixed of floating point number and integer, then you generally coerced to integer to floating point number. That is done in semantic analysis. That cannot be done in syntax analysis. Another thing is done, the plus overloading. So you know some language, not all, like in Java particularly, plus is overloaded. Here in Java, ABC plus ABC is ABC, 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 like this, and 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. So plus is overloaded. Sometimes it is addition between two integers or two floating point numbers, or sometimes it is concatenation, mainly in Java. That is, with this checking, meaning of this thing is checking done by semantic analysis. And then we will start little bit of error handling, how to handle different kinds of errors and all these things. And errors can be done at lexic analysis, like you name a variable, some start with numeric, because we know most probably all programming languages, we make a variable name starts with something ABC like this. So lexic analysis detect these in illegal variable name and other few things. And then syntax analysis, the missing parentheses, missing bracket, because you know the all reason of context free grammar is matching parentheses. So anything missing parentheses, and that's parentheses, it's called marker. We feel it that is a very essential for error handling, because there's parentheses or semicolon, they are called the markers. So whenever there's some error processing in bottom up parsing or top down parsing, we take out from the your parts till a marker is found. The marker is a opening braces or closing braces. So marker is very important term in error handling. Then you can ask that what can be in Python. That is an interesting case, because Python is white space. They use the white spaces, number of tab spaces as an indentation. So their technique should be different. So that's it. So we'll see this. The comparison semantic analysis was purely before the last class. We'll quickly review and then quickly go into the error handling and different stages of compilation. One interesting thing, this is, if you see the chapter 2 in Aho's book also, it is there. So now this particular in some books, if or in some public books, if you see, it's a binary tree, node is the operation that I told you, abstract syntax tree. And then it comes whenever you attach a string to it, like here, it is expression grammar. This is definitely is a bottom-up parsing, because if you see E is here, so it cannot be top-down. And we already know certain things we are now habituated with. So this is very relevant grammar. And because we are used to infix notation, so we do not use postfix notation in our day-to-day grammar, but computer can do the postfix grammar. We don't have any objection. So this is not purely expression grammar, because here we have E plus T minus T. If it is E star overloaded, if 30, then if you can see the multiplication is done ahead, then plus, then I can call it expression grammar. It's a part of expression grammar, not expression grammar. This is a simple example. I will show it to you. Here I want to mention that in computer, anywhere you go to the computer science, in data structure, and there is always, you see the very prevalence of, overpowering prevalence of binary tree, because binary tree can be done in a programming in if then else structure, if then else, if say then, say left, and else maybe right. It is easier to code, so everywhere you can see the, even in binary search tree, that is different, that is right hand side can be greater, or heap, min heap, the heap should be at top. So you can see two things, you can find it in computer science. One is stack, that stack is used heavily in function call, in top-down parsing, in bottom-up parsing, in depth-first traversal, in pre-order traversal, or post-order traversal, everywhere the stack is used. So one thing is stack, as another is binary tree. But here I have to mention to you, here you can, some books in certain notes you can find here two definitely there, and another you can be, this is attributed, that will be a particular string will be there and the semantic tree. And here in some books they shown it the minus and a separate and, but it is not a four-way tree, it is a two-way tree. Minus should be here and the string should, so don't confuse with the three-way or four-way tree. Syntax directed definition comes first, then syntax directed translation, and I told you this is a context sensitive analysis and all. And another thing I told you, this is two kinds of attributes. I again tell again and again, mostly ultimately they are all ill inherited attribute. Why I'm telling inherited attribute? All terminals are synthesized attribute, because terminals are coming from the, whenever the it get value, it will get the synthesized, then it will go to node, and it may be two kinds, synthesized or inherited. Because mostly Java, C and all, we declare the variable not context free grammar rule, that is a different, that is semantic rule you declare in the scope that int this, float this. So there the inheritance comes. So when the inheritance comes, it will overrule the synthesized. And I will tell you that all this variable can have zero attribute, can have one attribute, can have two attributes. So any variable can have ill attribute, that is from parent or from left sibling, elder sibling, or synthesized, or both. So inherited attribute can take the synthesis attribute also. So it is a basic synthesis attribute is different and ill attribute, inherited different. So any attribute, it can have both ill and s both. It's a type matching. And another thing, semantic analysis cannot correct it. There may be several errors. One is the syntax error, that is the missing parenthesis. Another is semantic error, that is type mismatch. One type mismatch again and again, but one thing I must tell you, that another type mismatch is whenever you declare a function, you have a arguments, your argument mismatch. In a, say Java or C++, the arguments expected, say maybe int, you give int float, like this kind of thing. So all this Python, it is more difficult, because you know the Python overload, it can be done in many ways. But I am now discussing regarding particularly C, C++ and Java. There you see if you declare a function, like C, you have to declare a function beforehand, function declaration, then you body of the function and other things you can write it later. And in program you call this, whenever you call this, there are two types. One is static checking, because at the compile time they see the certain indiscrepancy. Another is runtime. Runtime, it cannot be checked by these errors. So errors can be two type basically. One is at the compile time errors that we can handle, and runtime error that is can be handled by, you know, this is by exceptions. By Java and Python, they handle by exceptions, and certain hardware errors you cannot handle. But how to come out of it? That is error report. Error here means compile time and later on runtime. But we are mainly discussing the compile time. And remember, the error may be at the compile time, and you know, the after compilation you have to load it and link it. So at loading time, because whenever you compile a C file, then it will object file, .obj file comes, then whenever you load and link, then only the a.out or Windows .exe or .com file is coming. So at that stage, loader and the linker, there can be different types of errors that can be handled by loader and linker, and they report it to you. And after this, say executable file in say Unix like operating system like a.out will come, and Windows exe file will come. Then at whenever it run, the runtime error can come, or runtime exception we call it. So errors can be handled differently. We are forcing it or not, or mainly static checking. That is interesting, because in modern day language like Python, there's less even the static checking. All are basically dynamic checking, and you don't have to declare variable beforehand, whether it's integer or floating point or different types. So it is slower. The Python program runs generally slower than this Java, C++. There's a lot of other advantages there, because I particularly like Python because it handled integer number much better than C++ or Java, and it GUI and all these, it can bind to it, you can write a lot of things. But okay, there's still the Java and C++ has definite role, and they both these languages are very, very good language. C++, I particularly tell you, you should focus to your language learning skill, either C++ or Java or Python. Various companies give various importance, so you should go the educate. Because now you should revisit your chapter 2 of our book, because that is interesting. Chapter 1 and 2, particularly chapter 2, they cover all compiler stages in one chapter. So you should please read it, because it will be much clearer now, because we have already covered till semantic analysis intermediate code generation. So if you read the AHOS, this I have covered, like this is this production rule, this is typically context free grammar, and this is the semantic rule. This rule cannot be checked at the parsing time. So this is a pure semantic rule. But one thing we can argue that you can question that after syntax analysis fully done, then the semantic analysis cannot be begin. Partial answer yes or no. When the syntax analysis is being done, semantics can be checked at that time, or to understand right now, after semantic analysis should be done, but it can do parallel. After syntax, the semantic rule can be done parallelly, and you have to store the data in abstract syntax tree, and now we qualified the abstract syntax tree much better than the parse tree. That is a more general term. The abstract syntax tree or annotated parse tree or whatever, it is a annotated abstract syntax tree. So that's a beautiful name. And the annotated means you add the semantic rule associated at the node. This is so here give the synthesize is the you again and again, an inherited a attribute can have both synthesize and inherited, or synthesized or inherited single, like a attribute can have this L attribute. L means left and inherited. These two terms are there. One is syntax directed definition, another is syntax directed translation. It's two distinct stages in the semantic process. Then comes intermediate code generation. next stage. So this is every production rule. This is you can see it. It is a basically top-down parsing, because one Python I've heard this one version can be done by the top-down parsing. Top-down parsing is still relevant. It is not totally outdated. Some good languages can be done by the top-down LL1 parsing. That is easier to build. Maybe lot of languages in being developed for special purpose reason, for targeted programming and audience, not always general purpose. Till the top-down parsing is very relevant, LL1 parsing. So this is, you know, this is a top-down parsing. Yes, this all the production rule associated to semantic rule. This is very interesting thing in semantic processing, the particularly array bound checking, particularly in C. There is no such thing, but later on in Java and Python, there is runtime checking and all this. But in C, no checking. If you go to this array out of bound, blue screen might come. That is one of the reasons C is handled only a monolithic. Whenever you know your target computer is there, then you can use it. In the internet area, it is better to use Python, Java, or C++, better to Python, Java, Go, C hash, all these languages, because it can handle runtime exception better. But C, that way, at the time when it is developed, it is not there, because at that time memory is very precious, all memories are mutable, and you know, right now Java, Python, the most of the work is done in immutable area, that is not changeable. That is syntax written translation. Yes, it's parsable, is S attributed, like it's the bottom up parsing, and the line grammar is parsable, it's L attributed. Dependency graph is one more another important thing to understand. These are basically tools. It is these are one is semantics tree, it's annotated abstract syntax tree, that's a single name. We can run. Another is dependency graph. These are the tools so that no definition should be looped back. There is a cycle of definition of definition, then it will create a lot of errors. One must think, there is errors are various types. One error is logical errors. No compiler can correct logical errors. So logical errors means that the programmer thinks differently, code differently, there's some error in logic. That is not the compiler's role for correct these logical errors. So forget about logical errors. Then syntax rule, syntax checking, and the lexical analysis and syntax rule, they do the checking. Then the semantic analysis checks the this type coercion and type conversion. And more important is the that is not done in the mainly the syntax analysis. Whenever you're calling function, whether you're calling function with appropriate formal parameters, appropriate parameters. That type of checking is done at the semantic analysis. And for this checking, you need this dependency graph so that you can analyze the. From the graph, you can see whether there is possible error or not. You can see it. Yeah, this is important. I've told you this is compile time. Error, lexical, this includes misspelling of identifiers, keywords, operator, I've told you. Syntactical, missing semicolon, definitely an unbalanced parenthesis. Example, semantic incompatible value assignment of type mismatch between operator and operand. Logical, code not reachable. This is one interesting thing. Whenever you, this is intermediate code generation, I have told, I have given hints that you write a function, and there is some line number 3 or 4 you write return, then the some codes are there. That code, whenever if you have a unconditional return, and then you line 1 or 2 lines, that is unreachable code. So this unreachable code should be detected by this semantic dependency graph. So that will alert this code is not reachable. That is very good thing, because your program size will be less, and it will help the programmer. So unreachable code detection and all these things, it will be done at the semantic level. Anything you write something after return or something. All are errors. This is compile time. There are some other missing arrows are there, I should correct it to say loading type of error, linker type of error. Those are not discussed here. Another is runtime error can be hard errors, exceptions. You know how to handle exceptions in Java or Python. And now comes to the compile time, the lexical errors, spelling errors, exceeding the length of the identifier of a numeric constant, like you define numeric constant in a huge way in a particular language, appearance of illegal character, these are complex errors. Syntactic error in structure, definitely missing operators, yes. And the unbalanced parentheses or missing parentheses. The other type of syntactic errors can be there. What can be the semantic errors? Incompatible type of operands, that is type mismatching, undeclared variable. This is very important because you know in Python undeclared variable is okay, but C, C++, Java, it is not okay. And whenever your declaration is done, I have told you that is not a context-free grammar rule. That is different. So that, see, in Java, C, undeclared variable definitely is semantic error, but in Python it may not be error. So it depends on language to language. They are not matching of actual argument with formal argument. Yes, that is actually semantic errors. And this I'll discuss because of panic mode, phase level recovery, error production, and global. So panic mode will come when the compiler is coming out of the panic. It is generally done lexical phase with the panic mode error because it is meaningless. Syntactic error also panic mode is there. So you should know what is panic mode. Panic mode means whenever the error is found, the main purpose of the compiler is if you intentionally make one mistake in your code in Java, C, C++, or Python, you see that earlier time, at our time I have found it that if you make a single error, the number of errors becoming say 15, 20, and then we practice and we tell students also that whatever error you can find it at the first, you correct it and then all the errors will subsequently go, and it is generally that because if it is meaningless, if there is one error, is syntax error is there, further checking may help or might not help. So that you can but compiler should understand that is a distinct error, and from that error any other error messages should not be repeated again and again. It will alert you because it's a costly operation, so it will detect for few more other lexical errors and help you to return. So getting for one error and reporting that error in from 10 places, no use at all. So generally we call it the panic mode error. So that's it. Syntax error, the no phrase level, because syntax is the first stage. Then here I'll come what is phrase level and what is error production, global production, these things I use it. See, most of the symbol table partially syntax analysis, and now the lexical symbol table is heavily used. Is heavily used in the semantic error, because then the symbol table is not much used that way in the syntax checking, but it is used. I am not saying not used, but the semantic way is highly used symbol table. Now it is fully filled up by the both the stages, and there may be addition also. It is not that it cannot be added the symbol table. From a parsing, the error reporting is the quickest. So there could be handle, you can see in the top of the stack, because you know handle can one and only one handle, and that will be available at the top of the stack, and you can see the handle at the top of the stack in LR1 parsing. And then the input, whenever you matching it with your terminals, and you see that your parsing table, that box is vacant, so definitely error. And how to report the error, what are the things to take it out from the syntax, runtime, linker. Linker after the object file created of logical error, nobody can correct, semantic error. Syntax is a matching parenthesis, and that is kind of syntax analysis. This is that is compile time error. Typical semantics error, yeah, multiple declarations, the variable should be declared the same scope at most once. Yeah, that is multiple declaration you can have. But you know, in Python there's a different thing. In Python, in a small scope, you can write it, you can declare the global variable, unlike C, C++, or Java. You can declare some global variable within a function also, right in front of global, like this. So this is an interesting case we'll discuss at the end. Variable type mismatch, wrong arguments, I guess. This is the if you make it this parenthesis there, and anything you missed here, you put it something out this this thing, it will be semantics. It is not this whether it is string, whether it's a double quote or after double quote you put another string. All this checking cannot be done in syntax. It is only done by this. All this parameter level checking is done by, you can, as a semantic. So, thank you for viewing. Thank you.